following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
Moses, the mystery of Baphomet. We are following the sequence of lectures, as you can see, of the book of Genesis. Now we are entering into the third chapter that relates with the mystery of the serpent that you can see is in the first graphic of the PDF in the staff of Moses. And in the right we have Baphomet, which is a word that has to be read backwards. It means in Latin, peace of the Father to all men in the temple. We have to understand that when we address Baphomet, we are addressing that cherubim that is written in the book of Genesis, is the guardian of the doors of Eden. The cherubim, according to the tree of life, are those creatures of the world of formation, which is called Yetzirah, and which is the world related with Binah, which is the Holy Spirit in the tree of life. Kerub means strong. The strength of these angels are, of course, represented in many ways. And the strength is related, of course, with the sexual force. Since the world of Yetzirah relates to the world of Yesod, which is the sephira related with the sexual energy. And that is rule, I repeat, with Binah, which is the third sephira, or the first triangle of the tree of life. In the world of Yetzirah, we find different names related with each sephira of the 10 sephiroth that we call the tree of life. And of course, at the very top of the tree of life, we find the sephira Keter, that receives the name of Hayot Ha Kadosh, which means the holy creatures. And that's why when we address Baphomet, we are addressing as well the holy creatures. These holy creatures are mentioned in the book of Ezekiel, in the very first chapter, when he describes the four creatures that we call Hayot HaKadosh, sacred animals, and he addressed them and points that the legs or feet of this kerub or cherub that he is addressing has the feet of a calf, which, as you see, is a symbol, Kabbalistic symbol, that we find that is also related with Baphomet. Because when we enter into the world of formation, which is the world of Yetzirah, in Kabbalah we find many symbols of these sacred animals, which are called Haya or Hayot, plural. Haya is singular and Hayot is plural. This word Haya also means life. It means that when we are addressing the animals, Hayot HaKadosh, we are addressing the life which is within them, which in Sanskrit are called tattvas, and that we call the elements. That's why in Kabbalah and alchemy, when we address this Baphomet, the kerub, we are addressing the forces of the elements that synthesize in Yesod, which is the sexual energy. That is the only way to understand this mysterious Baphomet, which scares the ignorance. But in reality, it's just a symbol that you can see there related with sexuality or the forces of sexual energy. To begin, look at the caduceus of Mercury, which is making his phallus. This indicates that the energy that the initiate work with is a sexual energy in activity. That's why in the previous lecture I mentioned a word, temper. Tempered is a word that means, or when we address the sexual organ of the male, which is an erection. So therefore, this word temple resides within the word, the meaning of it has many occult meanings that we have to study it. To begin, as we are addressing here, peace of the Father. What Father are we addressing here? Of course, we know that the Father is Keter, the first Sephirah of the Tree of Life. And that the Father unfolds into the mysterious tree Da'at, which is the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and becomes the Father, Bina, which in different lectures we address. In Christianity, Bina is called the Holy Spirit, the same Shiva that received the strength of the first triangle or the tree of life. And this Shiva, in that, has his kingdom in Yesod, which is the sexual energy. Binah is what in Kabbalah is called Abba and Ima, Abba and Aima, father and mother, the duality of God that many times we said is hidden in the word Elohim. But this power also is in the holy name of God, Yod, He, Vav, He, which is translated as Jehovah. So, the feet of this symbol symbolize the forces of the earth, since the calf is a symbol of earth. And the earth receives the peace of the Father. In Gnostic axioms, we say, may peace be with you, so that you can be heirs of the light. What peace are we addressing here? When we said, may peace be with you so you can be heirs of the light, we are addressing, of course, the light of Keter, which is peace. That light descends from the crown, which is the Sahasrara chakra. That crown that is always protected in different religions. To begin with Judaism, the kippah, or the turban of the Sikh religion. And in many other religions, you see always that they keep that covering on top of the head, which symbolizes the covering of the light of the crown of the Father that everybody has here in different tonalities, according to the power of the pineal gland. So that crown chakra, that light, is what we call peace, that descends from the superior worlds. And that peace settles in the pineal gland, because the chakra Sahasrara, the crown chakra, relates to the pineal gland. And in the pineal gland, we have the atom of the Holy Spirit, the atom of Bina, the atom of Shiva. So therefore, you see how the light of the Father descends in the pineal gland, in the very center of the brain. That light is what we call the light, the peace of the Father. To all men. Now when we are addressing men, we are addressing manas, mind. That mind that utilizes the brain as a vehicle in the physical world in order to act. So the brain is a physical vehicle of the mind of the man. And we have in the cerebrum spinal nervous system what we call the throne of God, the throne of the Father. But it's something very important here that we have to address in relation with Binah, because we are addressing here the world of Yetzirah, the world of formation, where we find these creatures, symbols, that only the initiates know about. The light descends through what we call the cerebrum spinal fluid. You know that we have a fluid in the cerebrum spinal, in all the brain and the spinal medulla. It's floating on a liquid, a fluid. That is what is called the positive force of Binah, the positive force of the Father. That in alchemy is called Adam. So that force descends through the brain until the end of the spinal column. And this is precisely what we call the light of the Father. So when we said, may peace be with you, we are saying, may the light of the crown chakra, which captures the light of Keter, descends through your brain and through all your spinal column to all men in the temple. Because you know that Baphomet was a mysterious Kabbalistic symbol that were worshipped by the Templars, and that the ignorant people thought, oh, they are worshipping Satan, Lucifer. Well, it's related with it, because we are talking here about the sexual power. Lucifer is called light bearer, the bearer of the light, and that's precisely the cerebral spinal fluid that carries that light that we are talking about here, and that is Lucifer, that eventually will settle in the sexual organs, which is the other polarity of the sexual energy. Because the first polarity, the cerebral and spinal fluid, is Adam, and the other fluid is called Eve. And this is how we have to address this, because Adam and Eve had many symbols. But in this lecture, we are addressing the fluids. So the sexual fluid that is called semen. In alchemy, we address semen, female or male, physical bodies. So that is the feminine force that descends and becomes the sexual energy. In Yesod. Now, in the Zohar, which is that book that is a clue in order to understand the book of Genesis and all the books of the Old Testament, including the four Gospels in the New Testament, it states that the forces of Geburah were the ones that descended into the physical world in order to tempt Eve. So when we are addressing this, you see, we are addressing in the temple. Remember that we always say that the physical body is a temple of God, a temple that we have. It's called also a laboratory of the alchemists. So the temple is that energy, that vehicle, the physical body, where the energy of the Father descends and gives strength through Lucifer, which is the giver of light, which is synthesized in the four elements. So each one of us has his own Lucifer. But when we use that energy of Lucifer in the wrong way, in order to feed our own animal appetites, that Lucifer is transformed in Satan, the contrary. So the light of the Father will transform into Satan. It depends how we use the sexual energy. So when we address the sexual energy, understand, we are addressing Geburah, which is the left side of the tree of life. On the very top of the left side of the tree of life, let us go into one of the tree of life, the third graphic, in order to understand. We have two tree of lives here. One is in the right with symbols of the cherubim of Ezekiel. and also the serpent in the left, to indicate that the serpent, according to the book of Zohar, relates to the left side of the tree of life. On top of the left side of the tree of life, we find the Sephirah Binah, which is the Holy Spirit. So the Sephirah Binah, the Holy Spirit, rules Yesod, the third world, which is called Yetzirah. So underneath Binah, we find Geburah, justice, which is ruled by Samael. The book of Zohar addressed Samael many times. Our patriarch, the founder of this Gnostic movement in this day and age, is called Samael on Veor. That is the Dhyani Bodhisattva of that genie of Geburah. But this strength of Samael is in everybody, because it's a force of a logos, it's a cosmic force that relates to all human beings, even beasts, plants, minerals. It's a life. But related to Adam, the book of Zohar addresses Adam in relation with Geburah. And it is because in the world of God, Geburah receives the name of Elohim Gibor. Gibor in Hebrew also means man, male. So here, of course, we are addressing Geburah, Samael, in the head. That's why when you study astrology, you find two zodiacal signs that are ruled by Samael, Mars. The first is Aries. And Aries relates to the head. The second is Scorpio, which is related with Yesod. So it's understandable through Kabbalah why Samael rules Yesod and Geburah, because it relates to the head. It means that the force of Binah in that descends to Geburah down to Yesod. And descends in the way that we are explaining here, which is the cerebral spinal fluid, which is a positive aspect, the male aspect, which is Adam. That's why it is called the head, heaven. And that's why Samael in heaven and in Aries, Geburah, is called Elohim Gibor, which means the male power of God, which is a serpent. As you see, the form of the spinal column is a serpent going down. But of course, that male power transformed into a female power in Yesod, which is a Scorpio, which is called Eve. And that's why it is stated in the Zohar that when the division of sexes were performed by Jehovah Elohim, which is Binah, in Yesod, then the forces of Samael descended riding a serpent, a winged serpent of light. And was the one that talked to Eve in Yesod. If we do not understand all of these symbols and archetypes, we will fall into the mistake, as many Catholics, Christians, and many other denominations of Christianity, that curse Lucifer, ignoring which is the same light of Christ, That's why we call it Christus Lucifer, that descend from Geburah down into, in order to perform creation, or the creation of Adam. Behold here a big difference between Gibor and Adam. Gibor is the male force that, according to the book of Genesis and the Zohar, is that male force that was fighting with Jacob. Or Jacob was fighting with Elohim, and he won that fight. But that fight is internal. Jacob is a human soul trying to conquer the force of Samael within. So, as you see here, in all these symbols, we are addressing these mysterious forces of Baphomet, which relate to the left side of the Tree of Life. And the symbol of the left side of the Tree of Life on top, Bina, is Saturn. Saturn is controlling two zodiacal signs, Capricorn and Aquarius. Capricorn, of course, is a symbol of the goat. And that's why Baphomet has the face of a goat, or the head of a goat, which is a symbol of the power of God descending from Bina down in the sexual energy. Call there the two polarities, what in Sanskrit are called Ida and Pingala, in our own physicality. So therefore, Geburah is underneath Bina, which in the Zohar is called the power of the serpent, ruled by Samael. And beneath Samael, Geburah, we find Hod, which are related to the forces of the moon, and Yesod, in which we find that head in the Tree of Life, which is the head of the cherubim with horns, because that's the power that you have to conquer, the animal power. That's why Moses is represented in Yesod, being born from the waters. By studying the four creatures and the four elements, then we understand the fifth one, which is the serpent. It's a beautiful symbol, very well hidden. And people are always afraid of the serpent. But I want to explain it to you in relation with your physicality. What is that famous serpent? To begin, let us continue with this symbol like I follow in my brain, my mind. It's telling me now that I have to explain to you that in your head, in the world of Yetzirah, world of formation, the very top, Keter, is called Hayot HaKadosh, related to the four animals. In the invocation of Solomon, we say Hayot HaKadosh, cry, the eagle. Speak, the man. Roar, the lion. Bellow, the ox or the bull. And then after that, the invocation said, Kadosh, 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 which means holy. Hayot HaKadosh. But relates to Keter, the crown. And also, Kadosh, Kadosh, Kadosh is addressing the crown and the left brain and the right brain, or the two hemispheres of the brain, in other words, the triangle. In the Zohar, it states, or better say, the book of Ezekiel states that when that cherubim appears in front of him, he has four faces. The faces of the lion in the right, the face of the bull in the left, and in the eagle above, and has the face of Adam below. And the same ones, each face has the other faces. If you know alchemy, then you understand. It's easy. The lion relates to the sense of sight. The bull to the sense of hearing. The eagle to the sense of smell. And the mouth, Adam, to the sense of speech or taste. That's why it is written, you shall not taste of the fruit, because Adam is related with the mouth, the taste, the speech also, the word. So when you are addressing the four creatures of Ezekiel, you are addressing the four senses in your head. And then you will say, and where is the fifth sense? Sense of touch. When you read the book of Genesis, it's stated, you shall not eat of that fruit, says Eve. Not even touch it. Just by saying that, he's saying the serpent is related with the sense of touch, which is the fifth. But that sense, of course, is the one that put us in trouble. And we are going to explain here. But remember that we are addressing that cherubim. It's related with the four senses in the head. That's why the book of Ezekiel says that each face has the other faces. Because each sense is always related with the other senses. If you address the sight, when you are addressing the eyes of any person, you cannot avoid to see his nose, mouth, and ears. And if you see the ears, which is the bull of that person, you cannot avoid to see the eyes and nose and the mouth. And likewise with the other senses. This is how you easily understand what is that cherub. And it's because the physical body receives the light or the forces of the superior worlds through the senses. Light, sound, smell, taste. All of that is how the physical body fits itself with. And this is how you have to understand that in the lower level, we are that cherub. But we have to know how to take advantage of that in order to transform the energy, the light of peace, when we are in the temple. That's why we wrote there. Peace of the Father to all men in the temple. If you are in the temple, then that peace, that light, transform inside of you with the consciousness, with your mind. But if you are not in the temple, if you are listening to this lecture, you are there in another place thinking that tomorrow you have to go and do something else because it's a nice sunny day, you are not listening to the lecture. Maybe you are physically here, but you have to be in the temple. But alchemically also, to be in the temple means to control that energy in your Eve. Because in many lectures we have stated that the physical body is feminine. Before Adam being taken, or before Eve being taken from Adam, Adam was androgynous, hermaphrodite, within the fourth dimension, within Yesod. That's why you see in the graphic of the Tree of Life that the face of Adam there is androgynous. The power of sex is in his horns. But the serpent, which is on the left, is touching Malkut and even Klipoth, hell. in order to point that the physicality that we have is a fallen Sephirah. And we are, of course, in touch with hell, with Sheol, with Klipoth, through the serpent. Because the other creatures are related with the head, with Adam. It depends how we use the serpent. Because remember that Eve related with the serpent. And when Eve utilizes the energy in the wrong way, the sexual energy, infects Adam, the spinal nervous system, all the brain. And then Adam becomes polluted because of the action of the sexual energy, Eve. In order to continue now with this lecture, we had to go again to the first graphic in order to repeat. Peace of the Father to all men in the temple. That was addressing to the initiates, the Templars, in order for them to understand that when they are in the temple with the energy of the Father, they have to hold their peace. Because if they do not know how to hold their peace, they are kicked out of the temple. How do you keep the peace in the temple? Well, most of the Templars were men. That's why it says to all men. But the temple is the woman. Because the temple of God is a physical body. But isn't the power of the Holy Spirit forming the creature in the womb of the woman? Many say all religions are phallic. And it's true. Because all religions are formed from the light of Keter that descends in the cerebrum spinal fluid. But that fluid can do nothing without the sexual fluid, which is feminine. In other words, a male cannot engender a son if he doesn't find a womb, a woman that will receive his seed. The same way in religion. Religion exists because the strength of the Father, which is masculine, find the feminine, which is the temple. That's why in all religions, there are temples, churches, synagogues, mesquites. Any building is a symbol of the female aspect of God. Because God has to descend in the female force in order to spread his seed. And that's why when a male Templar wants to go inside of the temple, he understands that the temple is his wife. Because the womb of his wife is a church, is a mesquite, is a synagogue, is a force. It's called Zayin, the seventh letter of the Hebrew alphabet. The seventh day. That's why the woman rules home. It says that the man is the master of the house. But because the woman allows him to be. Because the real master of the house is the woman. And that is not necessary to give it a big explanation because any religion states with it. I mean, it agrees with it. But when the man wants to be in the temple, when a man wants to be a true man, he has to have a wife. A true initiate. Because we are talking here about the energy of the Holy Spirit. We are the energy of Binah, which is life, Haya, Hayot HaKadosh in the body. If you want to work with that fire, you have to work with the two polarities, the cerebral and spinal fluid and the sexual fluid, the two polarities of the sexual energy. In the sexual act, the man has to enter in the temple. That's why Baphomet has here the symbol of the caduceus of Mercury, symbol of the erection, phallus of the man. Because if the man is not erected, if his phallus is not tempered, he cannot enter into the woman. He cannot enter into the temple. The only way to enter into the temple of God, which edifies the mind and light the splendor of an eternal youth, is when the man is erected and receives and enters, and the woman, which is the divine symbol of the divine mother, the female aspect of God, receives him. And that's a symbol of that. Peace of the Father to all men in the temple. It's a symbol of chastity. Of course, ignoramuses take the symbol because they ignore about it and they make a mess of it. In this day and age, you see in the websites and the internet, many individuals are utilized there in order to scare the ignoramuses, without ignoring that the God is making the symbol of the positive pentagram in each hand. How to work with the moon. One moon below and one moon above. The moon, the forces of the moon, are the forces of the woman, which in the Zohar explains in different ways, as we are explaining here. Your own woman is your physicality. But if you are a male, you need a woman, a female force, in order to enter into the temple and to receive the peace of the Father. That's why the mystery that the Templars hide to all of them that were entering into the temple, they were receiving the doctrine of chastity. That was a great initiate that Master Samael on Veor knew in South America, whose name was the Dr. Arnold Krumheller, a great physician, doctor, from the University of Berlin. His inner name was Wiracocha. Master Samael on Veor mentioned Wiracocha in his book, The Perfect Matrimony. And he said, "This is the mystery of Baphomet. Instead of the coitus which reaches the orgasm, sweet caresses, amorous phrases, and delicate touching should be lavished reflectively, keeping the mind constantly separated from animal sexuality, sustaining the purest spirituality as if the act were a true religious ceremony. Nevertheless, the man can and should introduce the penis and keep it inside the feminine sex to bring about a divine sensation upon both, full of joy, that can last for hours, withdrawing it at the moment the orgasm is near to avoid the ejaculation of semen. The transmission of magnetic fluids is ordinarily done through the hands and through the eyes. But it is necessary to say that there is no greater and more powerful conductor, 1,000 times more powerful, 1,000 times superior to others, than the virile member and the vulva as receptive organs." This is what Master Wiracocha said. He, in other words, were disclosing the power of Baphomet. But many people didn't understand, even though he was not so clear. In order to enter into the mysteries, only Baphomet can give you that peace. Because you had to work with the forces of God in the very sexual act. Not as the ordinary people do, but as a Templar. Well, let us now go into this symbol in the PDF of the tetragrammaton, which is precisely another symbol that explains what we are trying to address here. Because in the tetragrammaton, you find in the very center the symbol of the phallus too, which is in the Baphomet, or the caduceus of Mercury, in other words. Exactly in the point of sex, when you find the letter omega of the Hebrew alphabet, alpha and omega. Alpha is above. You know that alpha is the same letter aleph, the very first letter in Kabbalah that symbolizes the Holy Trinity that we explained already. Underneath that, we find the word Adab Chava. We are showing this pentagram here because it's the first one that appeared publicly. Maybe it's another one that I don't know, but this is the first one that Eliphas Levi showed in his book in the 18th century. And was taken and modified, or not modified, but photocopied. And sometimes you find that the letter Mem at the end of the word Adam looks different. But I put this in the way as Eliphas Levi showed it. Some other people, instead of Adam, they write the word Adonai, which is wrong. The word Adonai means the Lord. And it's a symbol of the physical divinity. Malkut. The name of God in Malkut. Adonai. But the tetragrammaton, or the star of 5 points, the pentagram, it is stated very clear, it's a symbol of the perfect man. The self-realized man. And that self-realized man in Kabbalah is not Adonai, is Adam. Because in Kabbalah you said many names. As I said, Gibor means male and man as well. Ish also means male. Human being is Enoch. But Adam represents the perfect man because it is written that Jehovah Elohim, Bina, created Adam. Male, female. It doesn't say created Adonai. That's why Eliphas Levi represents the word Adam as a word Yod, the male aspect, because the head is that spat, which is the Yod, in which we find the Holy Trinity, which is above, which is the letter Aleph in the pentagram. So in the right, which symbolizes the cerebrum spinal fluid, is Adam. And in the left, as we are explaining here, is Eve. Hava is Eve. That's why Eliphas Levi wrote Adam Hava, which means Yod Hava, or Yod He Vav He, the tetragrammaton. And that's precisely how you see that in the arms of this pentagram, you find the symbol of Mars. And why is the symbol of Mars related with Adam, Hava? Because the right, Adam, is the cerebrum spinal fluid. The male, Geburah. And in the left is the force that descends to the sexual organs, which is Hava. That's why many ask, well, Eliphaz Levi forgot to write the word Yod there because it was so little that he forgot. No. The Yod is represented in Adam because this pentagram represents the androgynous, the perfect androgynous being, Adam into the image of God, male, female. And the right is Adam and the left is Eve, Adam, Chava. Simple as that. So it is a big mistake teaching there that the pentagram in the right means Adonai. Adonai is the name of God, of course, the Lord. But it doesn't relate to this symbol which we're talking here, which is the famous tetragrammaton, and which is also showing us the four elements. The cup is the water, the staff is the air, the sword is the fire, and the earth in the symbol between the word ton. And of course, the symbol of the serpent is the fifth. But understand that symbol is a symbol of Samael, the logos of Mars. And that's why when we address Samael, we address in that, but in a positive way. Because any logos is a demiurge that can be used for animal purposes or for human purposes. Because the forces of creation work in the animal kingdom, in the plant kingdom, in the mineral kingdom, and in the human kingdom. When we enter into initiation, then we learn how to utilize those animal forces of Baphomet or the animal forces of the Tree of Life, Hayot HaKadosh, in the initiation. Now, let us go into the next graphic. Here we find the quotation of the chapter of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 21, which says, and Jehovah Elohim, which is Bina, the Holy Spirit, caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. Many times, the book of Zohar states, well, doesn't say ribs, it says sides. One of his sides. But when we go deeply into Kabbalah, we know that the letter Vav is a symbol of Adam, the central column. And the letter Zayin is a seven letter. The difference between Vav and Zayin is simple. When you make the letter Yod and stretch it down to the right, then you make the letter Vav. But the letter Zayin is another Yod as well. But it's not stretched down to the right, but in the very center of the letter Yod. And that's the only difference between Vav and Zayin. Similar, right? And with both letters together, when they are joined, you find the letter Chet, which means life. Chai. In between the two forces. It means that Chet, life, Chai, was androgynous. That letter is an androgynous letter. And that's why the name of God in Yesod is Shaddai El Hai. Shadda or Shaddai is translated in many Bibles, in many parts, the Almighty God, El Shaddai, or the life of the Almighty God, Shaddai El Hai. But if you go into the dictionary and look for Shadda or Shaddai, you find that it's related with phantoms. Shadda. Shadda. Was precisely that genie that Solomon was controlling. The shed. Shin Dalet. Shed. If you study the story of Solomon, it means that he put under his service that shed. But that shed is the power of Yesod, is sex. Shaddai. That's why Shaddai is represented with horns. Because he's a keruv, a cheruv. Shaddai El means the Holy Spirit God or the phantom God. Chai, life. And this is something very important to understand because Chet, precisely, life, Chai. And when the book of Genesis is addressing the ribs, it means that the two polarities. Because if we go into the physical body, we know that we have many ribs, not two, we have many. But Kabbalistically, when we are addressing the two ribs, we are in the two polarities, male and female. That in the book of, in the world of formation, in Yetzirah, is androgynous. Adam there was male-female, as it is written. Form in the world of formation. And that precisely the point that when we go into the origin of this physical world in the past, when we talk about Adam and Eve, or Adam by itself, when still Eve was inside of him, we talk about two root races. The protoplasmic race and the hyperborean race that finally went down into the fourth dimension as the Lemurian race, which were hermaphrodites. So when we address the three previous races, we said Hyperborean, Protoplasmic, and Lemurian. And that is the race of the human being that existed before the division of sexes. The first root race was black. That's why we put now here in this graphic, black, Adam and Eve. Because really the very root of the races of the planet is black. After that came all the different tonalities. Because at the time of the protoplasmic race, the planet was very hot. And the people that existed, the protoplasmic people, were dark blue color. And of course, that was the Adam, Katmon. The primeval man, androgynous, that existed in the past. But then, of course, these human beings were the outcome of the work of alchemy in previous cosmic days. And that they were acting there in order to help creation. The division of sexes that we read in the chapter 2, verse 21, relates to the Lemurian continent. When the hermaphrodites, giant hermaphrodites, were giving birth the letter Zayin. Because the letter Zayin is the seventh letter that relates to Malkut. The physicality. It means that those gigantic hermaphrodites were given birth And instead of the letter Sain, or instead of the rib, as we said there symbolically, Jehovah Elohim, the Holy Spirit, through evolution, was closing up the flesh, whether male or female, and instead, the flesh was instead thereof, instead of the rib. When you read that literally, you think, oh, he took the rib out of Adam and closed it and put flesh in instead of the rib. But Kabbalistically, alchemically, the flesh, of course, you understand that, is a physicality that we have. That's the flesh. This organism that we have is covered by flesh, the skin. That's the flesh. And of course, that flesh in the male is a phallus. Or as we say, the flesh relates to the sense of touch. The sense of touch developed in order to work the forces of the elements in the division of sexes. This is what you have to understand. When the rib, which is the letter Zayin, is taken out and is putting flesh instead thereof, is a sexual organ. That is the flesh instead thereof. In this day and age, in the Hebrew language, they use the word Zayin. In Hebrew, of course, Zayin, for the sexual organ. If you write Zayin in Google, in Hebrew, not in English, then you will see that immediately the sexual organ appears. And it's very clear. When in our investigations, trying to find the meaning of it, immediately they say, oh yeah, of course. Instead of the rib, the sexual organ. That's the division of sexes. And that is the serpent. And each body, the flesh. That's why when God is taking Zayin, which is a female aspect of the androgynous, that force which is inside, because the rib is inside the body, when that energy, when that polarity is taken out, and then you find that that polarity expresses itself to the sexual organ, because the division of sexes is a division of sexes, male-female. And the serpent is the flesh. That's why in different symbols, you find, like in the next graphic, this is the mystery of Baphomet. This is what the Master Samael Onveo wrote in the book Igneous Rose. He says, the rose elaborates its perfume with the clay of the earth, which is the physicality. The slithering worm does not like the gardener who removes its clay. Our disciples will now comprehend on what basis do the tenebrous ones qualify the sexual alchemists as thieves. And the proof is this. When you read the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 25, the very bottom of that chapter, it is written, and they were both naked. But we put in parentheses the word that they use for naked. If you copy that word and put it in the dictionary, you will see that has many meanings. And one of the meanings is thievish. And it's because it is precisely what an alchemist, a Templar, the one that knows the mystery of Baphomet, does. He steals the sexual force of nature. And as you see there, this graphic of Buddhism, how both had the face of a serpent, a thievish face. You have to know how to steal the energy from your own physicality, because that physicality, that flesh, is your own body. Matthew Samuel says, or the Genesis says, and they were both thievish, Adam and his wife, and were not ashamed, because they were stealing from their own development, spiritual development. Now the devotees of the path will understand why Christ said, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Because this is how you develop the forces of heaven within you. The forces of heaven descends in your physicality, and you take it by force, by willpower. It's not easy. The weak succumb in the sexual act. And that's the mystery of Baphomet. You have to be a thief. And that's why the tenebrous, the fornicators from Klipoth, accuse the alchemists of being thieves. Because we, when we transmute, we are really thieves. We like to steal for God. Remember the Lord Christ crucified between two thieves. The right one is the one that is with the Lord, stealing for him. But it's not a stealing like in this physical world, money or dollars, because that's stupid. He's stealing from his own energy, his own force, his own physicality. The left, the thief of the left, is stealing in order to satisfy his own bestiality. And that is abundant. The body always nourishes, takes all the energy. And what is what we do? We steal it for the ego, for our lust. But when the division of sexes happened, for a reason, the reason is that we had to build the man, Adam, androgynous, within the inside of the intellectual animal. Now the question emerges. But the previous races, protoplasmic, hyperborean, Lemurian, were human beings already. Why were then this complication of creating a world to create the human being when he's already created? Well, not all the monads created Adam. And remember that through the law of evolution, through the mineral kingdom, plant kingdom, animal kingdom, Hariot HaKadosh, the creatures, are coming in evolution, and they need to receive the opportunity to become human beings into the image of God. So therefore, in the scenario of Lemuria, there were human beings already there. And these creatures, when they were divided, these human beings were divided in sexes, they were having children. In other words, they were given physicality to the monads, to the souls who were coming from the animal kingdom. That inheritance, that gift was precious, because the animals, souls from the animal kingdom, were receiving human bodies that were already the outcome of chastity, because the Lemurians were multiplying through chastity, not like animals. So the animals entering into those bodies were learning already by instinct how to transmute. They were receiving that teachings. But of course, they were also having their past, because all animals are fornicators. And they were entering into the human kingdom through that way. They had to learn not to fornicate. And the angels, of course, incarnated in Lemuria, were guiding them when they were in the temple. That's why it's written that the sexual act was performed in the temples. Because in the temple, when the phallus is united with the vagina, and that union is Yod-Havah, Elohim Hava. And that union is when the man is inside the temple. So if you are following any religion and you are in the temple praying to God, but you are not in the very sexual act invoking God, you are committing blasphemy. Because when you are in a sexual act, according to the Zohar, you have to pronounce E-A-O, which is Yod-Heh-Vav, the name of God. But how many people pronounce that name? Or they don't even pronounce it. And in the sexual act, they forgot God. They don't remember God. In the sexual act is when you have to remember God. And you want to synthesize that E-A-O, and then you said, because that powerful mantra synthesizes Yao, the force of the serpent. And you transmute the sexual force. That's the mystery of Baphomet. That is taught by Moses through his Kabbalah in all the book of Genesis. Let's go into the other graphic. In order to understand better this mystery of the serpent. You see there, the first verse of the chapter 3, it is stated, and the serpent became wiser than any receptacle beast genie. That's precisely the forces of Yesod, Ha Shaddah and Chayi or Chayot, relates to the world of Yesod, the world of formation, the world of creation, which Jehovah Elohim had made in Eden and said unto the woman, it is true that Elohim had said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. At the end. Of course, in the Garden of Eden, you find specifically is written three trees. The first one says that Jehovah Elohim created every tree pleasant to the sight. And then after that says, and the tree of life and the tree of good and evil in the midst of Eden. Three. What is this pleasant to the sight? When we see a physical body, that's a tree. Our physicality is a tree that captures energy. Pleasant in Hebrew means neshamad. Oh, no, neshamad. I'm sorry. It's nehamad. Or nehama. Pleasant to the sight. And it's because when the division of sexes happened in Lemuria, women were very attractive, as it is written by the book of Genesis. Fleshy speaking. The beauty of the body, the physical body, is related to the sexual organs. When the woman entered into puberty, the skin, the forms of the physicality absorb the hormones of her ovaries. And likewise in the man, the hormones of her testicles. And this is what a man is full with muscles, strong testosterone. But the woman is different. Two types of flesh. The woman, of course, if it's normal, like the flesh which is pleasant to her sight, which will be a male. And for the male, will be, which is normal, of course, a female, which is pleasant to his sight. And that's precisely that. But the tree of life is a spinal column in the middle of the physicality. And the tree of good and evil, which is the sexual organs, divided already into sexes. But why is the serpent related with it? Especially in this graphic, you see, you find this woman, which is called, we could call Lilith, could call Nahema, or Hava, Eve. Because the woman receives precisely the, how you call, point, or is pointed as a perpetrator, right, of the fall of humanity. But when we're talking about the woman here, you have to understand and visualize that we are talking about the sexual energy, the physicality as well, and Zayin, the left side, or the polarity of sexuality. And of course, the serpent, which is surrounding the physical body. The serpent, when you touch a serpent, you find this skull animal. And in this graphic, you see how the serpent is around the physical body of that woman. And it's because our woman is our own physicality. And the serpent which is going around is the skin, is the flesh that we have. Because Samael, that rules Aries above, rules a Scorpio below, our sexuality. But our sexuality is the fifth sense, touch. As Master Wiracocha says, to the hands, when you relate to the sense of touch, you said, my hands. When you embrace a woman as a male, or a male, or a female as another male, you arouse the sexual force because both skins are touching, the flesh is touching, the two serpents, in other words, are touching of the caduceus of Mercury. That is the sense of touch. Hence, everything enters in relation of that. And that precisely the serpent that tempted Eve, the sexual organ. Because when the energy is aroused, then the men receive erection, the woman humility, and they perform the sexual act. Because the most sensitive organ of the flesh, as the book of Genesis says, Zayin was taken out, and instead of that, flesh was put. That flesh is the physicality, the physical body. And that flesh is the sexual organ. When men and women are in contact in the sexual act, that's the flesh of the serpent. Or as Decameron, this great alchemist of the ancient times says, the phallus is the devil and the vagina is hell. When the devil is in hell, then you have temptation. You have defeated. Because temptation is fire. But the triumph of a temptation is light. But who defeats temptation? When the devil is in hell, everybody wants to go down to hell too with it. Or with him. And this is humanity. It's a humanity, they like to be in hell with the devil. Knowing, of course, that the force of the devil is Baphomet. But when you were entering into the temple of the Templars, they were teaching you how to utilize your sexual energy wisely. Because the serpent was the wisest, or the wiser than any receptacle. It means that the other beasts that we're talking about, Hayot HaKadosh, the sight, receive energy, the impressions. Also the ear receive impressions. The nose receive impressions of the light. The taste when you eat any type of food. And your body is nourished. But the most sensitive organ that receives that light, especially in the sexual act, is the flesh. And that is the serpent. Physically speaking. Because that serpent relates to different ways, alchemically speaking, inside of you. Now you understand. When in the ancient times, the Lemurians were performing the sexual act in the temples, they were warned against the serpent. But one day they performed the sexual act out of the temples, and they were victim of the serpent, of their own skin. They were aroused, and without the help of God, of course, because they didn't invoke God, they were out of the temples. There was only Lucifer there with them. And they, of course, fall into animal generation. That's how they fell. So don't be afraid of serpents, because then take all the skin of your body, and then you say, okay, now I don't have any serpent. It will be only muscles. So understand that. Now let us go into the other graphic. When the serpent, the flesh, is tempting Eve, the sexual organ. He says, but Jehovah told you not to eat from the fruit, which is, the fruit is precisely the feminine aspect of God, the feminine force of Elohim. That's the fruit, which is in the sexual organs, because the masculine force is in the sexual, in the cerebral and spinal fluid, and the other is in the sex. And then the woman says unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree, which is the genitalia in the midst of the garden, God said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. But the serpent says, according to Zohar, God only said, don't eat it. You can touch it. And this is precisely the mystery. When you are in the sexual act, you are touching the tree of life. But remember the commandment, don't eat of it. And the clue is to invoke God in the moment when you are penetrating the woman, or when the woman is receiving the man. Remember God, because is the sexual act is his feminine power. But if you forget God, you touch the tree and you eat the fruit, and that's precisely the problem. You can touch it, but don't eat it. Because by touching it is how you transform the energy and feed your spirit, your soul. But if you eat it, and then you create images inside of you, false Elohim, and then you become an idolatrous. You shall not make any idol inside of you. When you fornicate, you make lust, and then the rest of egos inside. And you become idolatrous. Even if you don't have in your home statues, and you think that only God you worship, but you are a fornicator, you are also a killer. Because you are killing the life. Or as in esotericism we say, any bodhisattva that falls into animal generation is accused of having killed the god Mercury, or the Mercurius, which is the sexual energy. So any fallen bodhisattva is a killer. You shall not kill. You have to read that last article that refers to what you do, or what are you performing when you are in fornication. The Zohar explains the different. You are a thief as well, but a bad thief. A good thief, you see, because Adam and Eve were thievish, but they were not ashamed. But when you are stealing for the devil, after that you feel shame. After the orgasm of the animals. And the serpent said unto the woman, this is the next graphic, ye shall not surely die, for Elohim doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as Elohim, knowing good and evil. But when you eat it as God, or with God, together with God, and you eat it, and then your eyes are open. But it's written that Adam and Eve, or whether Eve tasted the fruit, which was the orgasm, that they taste, and give it to the brain. And both saw that they were naked completely, without energy, without force. But let us read Numbers 21, 8, 9. Because this is what the serpent said to Eve. But Jehovah said unto Moses, and we put into parentheses Adam, because in the previous lecture we associated Adam with Israel and with Moses. So when we are addressing Moses, we are addressing Adam, or the initiate that is following the path. And Jehovah said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole. Now the spinal medulla. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten by a serpent, when he looked upon it, he shall live. Obviously, the one that is bitten by the tempting serpent is the one that succumbed to fornication. The one that reaches the orgasm is bitten. But if you worship the serpent of brass, which is the symbol of the duality of the Divine Mother within, then you shall live. And Adam and Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, remember that the male is the mind, the cerebral spinal fluid. If you receive that poison in your mind, then you had to do the opposite and to be cured. When you beheld a serpent of brass, he lived. Remember that the eyes are the lion. To see the light, to see the serpent, is to close your eyes and to invoke the feminine aspect of God, which is the serpent of brass, the divine serpent Kundalini in Sanskrit. And that's precisely what Moses was doing by the command of God. So we have two serpents here. The first is the tempting serpent, and the other is the serpent that gives life, which is the Kundalini. Humanity is following, of course, the tempting serpent. Because in the sexual embrace, when the flesh is receiving that magnetism and male and female, they enter into the temple, but to fornicate. And that's precisely to filth the tabernacle of God. When you enter into any temple physically here to pray, you put your sinful thoughts out and you kneel and pray to God, right? Same thing when you enter into the temple of God, which is the living temple, the woman. And when the woman receives the man, is receiving the positive force of God. So then it has to be like in the temple, a religious ceremony. Religious ceremony, religion, religare, to unite. That means to be religious. To unite the positive forces and the negative forces inside your body and when you are in a sexual act. That is to be religious. But if you don't do that and call yourself a religious person, you are just lying to yourself, and you shall not lie. Let us go down into this mystery of Baphomet, into what was explained in the previous lecture by the other speaker. Azoth. You find this word Azoth written with Hey, Zayin, Aleph, Tav, in the chapter 21 of Genesis, verse 10 and 11, which is directly related with Abraham. That related with Abraham is Chesed, our own particular innermost, that has to do the work inside. That force that descends from the cerebral spinal fluid. That is Abraham, the father. That's why it is written that through his seed, religion will be received and also it will multiply. The seed of Abraham. But we have two here. Two children, right? That are mentioned in the Bible. Ishmael. Ishmael means God listen. When you are receiving this doctrine, you are listening. Then you are entering into the kingdom of Ishmael. Because the forces of Abraham descends and also create in the physical world. But it is written in that verse 10 and 11, and Sarah saw the son of Agar the Egyptian, which she had borne unto Abraham, mocking. What do you imagine that? I mean, Sarah already has Isaac. And she was sterile. But Ishmael is mocking. Now, what is Ishmael? Ishmael is our physicality. When we enter into this path, Ishmael is our physicality. We are receiving knowledge, we are receiving the doctrine, we go into religion, into our temples, churches, synagogues, mesquite, whatever, and we are very religious people. That Ishmael. Because Ishmael is the son of the Egyptian. Egypt is Keb, dark earth, as we were showing there, is a physicality. Or Mizrahim, as it says in the Bible. And of course, Hagar, the Egyptian, symbolizes our own physicality. Or the physical world, in other words. Because when you address Egypt, you are addressing Malkut. And this is precisely, there are many organizations here, many groups, which are Ishmael. But when you enter into this initiation, and when you follow the path of Baphomet that we are explaining here, which is the path of transmutation, and then your inner divine mother inside of you give birth Issac, which is the child of the promise, in other words, of chastity. Now remember that in the physical world, Abraham also had Ishmael. In other words, to synthesize and for you to understand, this physical body that you are seeing here in front of you is Ishmael. Issac is inside of me. That is the child of chastity that is being born from my divine mother. But Abraham, which is Chesed, is the father of both. You understand that? Issac is inside and Ishmael is physically here. This is Egypt. But Ishmael is mingled with Klipath because below Malkut is hell, Sheol. And of course, he's mocking because we have ego. And this is what happened in this physical world commonly. The physical person, whatever his name is, whatever his nationality, is to start mocking things, spiritual things, or boasting of, oh, I am the master such and such, my inner God is that, the prophet this, in past lives I was this and that, you know, mocking. And then Sarah, the divine mother, says, wherefore, she says unto Abraham, which is the innermost, that is the one that can give you light or take light from you, physically speaking, says, cast out this Azoth, this physicality, which is outcome of the Azoth, the sexual energy as well, as we learned in the previous lecture, which is a bond woman and her son. For the son of this Azoth bond woman shall not be heirs with my son, even with Issac. Master Samael always warned in his books, do not talk about your initiations. Do not talk about your spirituality or your development. Because when you start talking about that thing, you are mocking like Ishmael. And then your inner God, Abraham, Chesed, cut you. And then you enter into darkness. And said, why? I was receiving a lot of light and all of a sudden I don't receive the light. Because Sarah says, I prefer you give all that light to my son Isaac inside, which is Geburah, than to this mocking individual in the physical world. But it's the same individual. It's the same one. And when you know the difference, then you start shutting your mouth. It says, I, Ishmael, wants to receive the light, wants to receive knowledge in order to help humanity. But I have to understand that the one that receives the doctrine and powers and initiations is Isaac, Geburah, up there in heaven. Not me, not this personality. Or starting accusing others in the wrong way, and then you fall into mocking, which is precisely in this day and age the problem for many Gnostics. They start mocking other Gnostics. And there's a lot of mockery everywhere now. So the inner God cuts that. He says, not only in the internal worlds. And if you want light, you have to fight for it. But are other Ishmaels that receive the doctrine, Gnostic doctrine, or the Kabbalah, whatever? And there are many. Because it's written that the children of the born woman are millions, thousands. But the children of the free woman, Isaac, are very few. I mean, those that develop inside. And we know that. Because you find many Gnostic groups in this day and age. The doctrine of the Master Samael, which is the doctrine of the serpent, as you can see, can give you a lot of wisdom. But if you don't practice it, you remain being Ishmael. And you can develop power. I remember in this very moment, when I was invited to a reunion of Gnostics, a certain group of Gnostics, and they told me, come into us. Look, we are many. We are a lot. He said, yeah. Not only your group is a lot. There are other groups that are a lot. But that's not the point here. Why we want to be with you? Just because you are many? Ishmael. Where are the children of the free? Isaac. Those are quiet. Don't say anything. But just because you are many, I'm going to belong to your organization. I said, no. Maybe our group also will be also many. But who are the ones that are going to be serious in this? Because you always find that Ishmael persecutes Isaac. And are all those envious people that do not do anything and that are slaves of Baphomet and don't control the forces of Baphomet. So they start accusing others. In this day and age, they accuse the alchemists of being thieves. And when I read that, it says, a thief, a plagiarist. Yeah, it's true. I don't deny that. I am a plagiarist. I am a thief. Yeah, but a good one. Because I'm working for my God. Right? In that way, we understand. But there are others that are not working and they are getting mad. Right? All these, the alchemists are not thieves. The Master Samael says very clear. All the alchemists are accused of being thieves because they are thieves. And they are not ashamed. So when you understand the doctrine, you don't feel ashamed. Shame on you. Well, if you want to understand very well the Azoth, that is precisely the female aspect, the force of the serpent. That's the Azoth. The Azoth is the force of the woman, the energy of God. That's the Azoth. And you can multiply here and make a lot of disciples, and then God will promise make also in Ishmael a great nation. Many religions that are great nations. You find many millions of Catholics, millions of Jews, Muslims, Buddhists. That's Ishmael, a lot. But to find Issac in them is very rare. And that's why Paul of Tarsus in Galatians chapter 4, verses 19 to 31, talks very clear. It says very clear that Hagar symbolizes Egypt, Arabia, Malkut, as we were explaining here. And of course, are two covenants, or two ways in which you learn. Here, you are learning now. You are being Ishmael, you receive the doctrine of Hagar. As Ishmael, you are multiplying and being many. But if you want to receive directly into your consciousness the Kabbalah, to receive the light directly from your God, and then you have to create Issac, as you've read in the last graphic of this PDF, that Paul of Tarsus, the master Hilarion, explains very clear. There are two covenants. The one that develops in this physical world, and that everybody is preoccupied, making a lot of disciples, devotees, in order to preach the light to them, good. But if they don't practice inside, if they don't defeat the temptation of the serpent of their own flesh, they just remain as in this day and age. A lot of people that claim to be Christian, to be Jews, to be Muslim, to be Buddhist, but nothing inside. Is it how you call it in English? Wannabes, right? Oh, I wanna be. Yeah, well, to be really is inside, to practice, to become like Issac, the son of the promise. And that promise is chastity. That promise is what the Master Viracocha says, to defeat temptation. But remember, the stronger the temptation is when the man and the woman are in the sexual act. Then you feel the fire of the devil, the fire of Lucifer, and that's the temptation. And that's the serpent, their own flesh. And the sexual organ, the most sensitive organ of the sense of touch. In that moment, you have to defeat the devil. If you don't defeat the devil, you are a victim. And you are kicked out of Eden. You want to return into Eden? Well, defeat temptation and make light within. And then you enter. And this is precisely what the Lemurians were receiving at that time in the temples. But they were victims of Lucifer and they fall into animal generation. And as you know, most of those gigantic Lemurians were having sex with animals because they were animals within. And this is something that you have to understand. The Lemurians that have sexual relations with animals were not the human beings. Were the animals that were receiving human bodies in order for them to have the opportunity to become humans inside. But they fail. And they multiplied animals because they were animals within. And they created all those apes that according to the Master Samael is very well explained in the book Gnostic Anthropology. You can read that. I don't want to read it for you because it's long. You can read it. We will put it if the transcription comes and for everybody. Now, if you have questions, you can ask and we can increase this knowledge. of Baphomet. Yeah?
You don't reach, you don't approach the orgasm, meaning you're just transmuting the energy that's there, but it doesn't build up to orgasm, even though you're going to avoid it. Will the same amount of energy still be transmuted as if you didn't? Do you understand the question?
Well, it's a very long question. let me tell you one thing. The question is related with the transmutation of the sexual energy when you are being tempted by Lucifer. And that Lucifer is the same serpent, right? Because people now are looking for the serpent. Who is the serpent? The serpent is your flesh. It's your skin. That's the serpent. When you are in a sexual act, you are victim or defeating temptation. That's what it, but if you want to follow the rules, read the last article that we place in the website that is called Good and Evil. Because the rabbis of the Zohar explains very well what you have to follow. It says, for instance, Zav, which is command, is the first, it says, and Jehovah commanded Adam. Zav, command, means not to fall into idolatry. That's the first. Not to fall into idolatry means that in the very sexual act, your mind has to be clean, only concentrated in God. But if you are in the sexual act and you are thinking lustful things, obviously you are worshiping an idol. You are an idolatrous, and you will fall victim of it. That's why you have to, this Master Samael on the earth says, the power of transmutation resides in the mind. And the power in order to control the mind is willpower. It's Moses. You have to control it. And that's precisely in the very sexual act. And if you follow that article, I repeat, you will find the different steps because you have to invoke Jehovah, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, in the sexual act. Because you shall to pronounce the name Jehovah in the sexual act because Jehovah is the one that do that transformation. And Jehovah is synthesizing E-A-O, or the letter S, in the sexual act. Meaning that you have to pronounce the name of God in the sexual act. You don't have to pronounce the name of God in vain. But in the sexual act, that is not in vain because help me, God. If you forget God, you fall. And of course, as well, when you are working with your ego to make righteous, to be a righteous person, you have to work with Elohim. And as I repeat, study that article, the Zohar, in order to understand how to perform a sexual act. The article is called Good and Evil by Shimon Ben Hohai. Sense of touch is a serpent.
So the better that it feels, right? Just the crude words. The more it feels good, even when you're following the rules and you're praying to God, there's more transmutation than if it just feels like okay. You understand where I'm from?
Yeah, obviously in the sexual act there are many temperaments and many levels. And it's obvious that the sexual act is always pleasurable. It's always. The serpent gives glory in light. You know, that's precisely the point here. People say, oh, damning, cursing the serpent. Without the serpent, you cannot have life. Because the serpent, the skin, that flesh of energy, that receptacle, which is the skin, gathers a lot of energy that gives that sexual strength to the man and to the woman. And obviously, in the sexual act, it's always pleasure. Right? That's why there's a commandment, you shall not eat. Right? But it is the most difficult commandment because Not to eat means to perform the sexual act and to transmute. To eat means to reach the orgasm, the spasm of the animals, which in this planet Earth, everybody's eating, having a feast of the apple of tree, right? And following, of course, Lilith and Nahema. But you have to be careful, because in the sexual act, you have to be, if you want to learn, you have to start little by little. Don't start like great master of Tantra, you know, that practice hours. The master with a question says, they can endure for hours, right? But you say, oh, the master with a question says that can endure for hours, but you are not a master. He was a master with a question. He says, you have to start, the master Samael says, you have to start for 5 minutes, 15 minutes, or as much as you can tolerate in order to teach your body, because the serpent is wiser. You know, is a wiser animal of all the Hayot that were created by Jehovah Elohim, because Jehovah Elohim created that. He took the Zayin and put the flesh instead thereof. Now we are here. Now you know. Another question? Yeah? The pentagram. Okay. Let's go into the pentagram. Let me the helper here. The next, there. That's the pentagram. That's the pentagram or the tetragrammaton of Eliphaz Levi. Adam and Hava. Or you can read it Eve also, because the letter He is a vowel as well sometimes. And the letter Vav is V, Eve, Eve. Oh yeah, it's a good question. The thing is that we are addressing here the God into the image of God. It's just Adam Hava. But when you address the female, Hava is with Chet, right? It's because Hava, as we were explaining here, is a sexual organ. Hava with Chet means Zayin and Vav together. But when you take Zayin out, and then it's Hava. But it's the same meaning. With het or with hey, it's always addressing the female aspect of God. But with het is when you are working with it. Because remember that Hava, it says, because is the mother of all the living. Meaning that the living are the ones that transmute the energy. Those are the living. Hava. But above, when you are already self-perfected, you are no longer Hava, but Hava, Adam, Hava, an androgynous that doesn't need sex. Question?
Is it Isaac or Ishmael who is going to be sacrificed?
Both. Who is the one that is going to sacrifice by Abraham? Isaac or Ishmael? Well, Isaac is forgiven, and the one that is going to be sacrificed is Ishmael, of course. Isaac is the one that is going to be killed. But the angel says, no, don't kill it, kill the other. Which is, of course, the symbol of the animal, the lamb of the goat. But that killing means psychological, not physical. Meaning that Ishmael has all the defects, vices, and errors within Malkut. That's why he's mocking, right? So the one that is being sacrificed and at the end is sacrificed is Ishmael. But I repeat, understand that alchemically. It's not a physical killing. It's alchemical. To make righteous Ishmael, you have to build a bodhicitta to annihilate that which is unrighteous in Ishmael is to annihilate the ego, to clean the two moons, Lilith and Nahema. This is what you have to understand. That in the end, of course, because Issac remains in heaven, but Ishmael remains in the physical world. But always listen. And listen, you, Ishmael, you had to die. Yeah. Yeah, okay. The woman is the one that is saying to the serpent. But when you read what Jehovah Elohim said, is that you shall not eat of it. Right? And the woman says, not even touch it. Right? But then the serpent, according to Zohar, said, no. The thing is, you shall not eat. You can touch it. Look, I touch it and I don't die. And it's true. Because the Elohim touches and I don't die. But if you eat it, you will die. But and then when Eve said, okay, I will touch it and I will try not to eat it. But she ate it and gave it to Adam. And they liked the orgasm. He says, oh, this is a good fruit. He says, you forgot about that. It's for animals, not for us. And then they are kicked out of Eden, etc., etc. Another question? Sight, wiser. Well, you have to educate your senses. Remember that in the path of the self-realization, you have to educate your sight, your hearing, your smell, your taste. We teach about that in many lectures. You have to educate your senses. Because remember that those senses act through the flesh. The serpent encircles all of them. That's why it's wiser than any of those beasts, all those senses, in other words. So, of course, being single, there is an exercise that is called Bahroli Mudra, in which the single person touches with a sense of touch his sexual organs in different ways and learning to transmute. You can learn that in the website. Teach here because it's very graphic. But it's called Vahroli Mudra, in which the single person touches himself, right? Not in the masturbation way, because that's negative. That's precisely touching the serpent in a filthy way. Vahroli Mudra teaches you how to transmute your sexual energy, your flesh, in order to be in chastity when you are single. If you are married, you don't need that. Because you face there your own Eve, or Eve, your own Adam, in the very sexual act. And that temptation is stronger. Follow the second graphic, the advice of the Master Viracocha. Withdraw before the orgasm. Another question? Good question. Precisely, this is what we are explaining. What does the male, if he has an erection of the phallus, will transmute better? The Vahroli Mudra teaches that. You have to give a massage to the sexual organs in order to transmute, in order not to lose the erection of the phallus. And also for the woman, the same thing. But it has to be done, of course, with the invocation of Allah. With the invocation of Jehovah, Yao, your divine mother, your divine father, otherwise you fall. This is the way in order to be born again. Question. Another question.
Does eating also refer to oral sex?
Does eating relate to oral sex? That oral sex is animal. 100%. Eating means to eat of the fruit. Remember, we explained in the beginning. The lion relates to the sight. The bull relates to the hearing. The eagle relates to the nose, the smell, and taste. To eat with the mouth relates to Adam. To eat of the fruit means that you utilize your head in the wrong way to the sexual organ. And that's precisely the point here in eating. In this day and age, that vulgarity relates to the oral sex. Observe any mammal, cat, dog. They always do that because they are animals. You want to be a human being, you have to stop being an animal. But if you don't want to be a human being, then keep being an animal. And that's precisely the point. Another question? The karma. There's no karma there. In this case, for a woman that cannot reach the orgasm, why, if you cannot reach the orgasm, you have to fight for it? It says, you cannot be an animal because you don't reach the orgasm. Then fight in order to be an animal. That's incongruent. In this day and age, it's precisely what people receive, teachings. That some women are difficult to reach the orgasm, so they have to teach her. Women are, in past times, chased by nature. But in this day and age, there's a lot of pornography there and filthy things that teach the woman how to fornicate, how to reach the orgasm, and that's bad. In other words, the woman had to be more bestial as she already is, and how the man can be more bestial as he already is. But remember, the choice is yours. Take the path of the good or the evil. It's up to you.
When Adam was androgynous and was then split, is the split related to a spiritual concept of the division of a soulmate? I'm not referring to our current egotistic concept.
The split of the soulmate, the split of Adam and Eve, well, yeah, it's true. That explains the split of the that we explained in previous lecture, how Adam meets his soulmate through initiation. But here we are talking about the descension of the power of creation into the physicality. And that, of course, that is splitting of the forces is in order for us to learn how to find our own soulmate, spiritually speaking. In this physical world, you can find, of course, somebody that made you mentally, emotionally, spiritually. That is good. But the real mate is inside. Because, as we explained in other lectures, if you have ego, your soul mate has to have ego. Otherwise, it doesn't mate you. Right? Doesn't match you. You have anger? Well, your soul mate has to have anger too. That's your soulmate. But if you want your mate for your soul without ego, well, you have to enter into initiation and to resurrect and to enter into the Garden of Eden, which is Yetzirah, Yesod. And when you reach that level, then in another creation, in another planet, you can become as an androgynous person. And through evolution, eventually, your being will divide you in two sexes, and with your other mate, you will have children, according to the law of God, in order to give opportunity to new monads, new souls, to enter into the path of Baphomet. Can I pronounce the mantra that the master advises in the perfect matrimony after vocalizing seven times E-A-O? You have to pronounce the mantra Kavla Kav Zavla Sav Zesar. Now the mantra in order to unite the superior and the inferior, the physical personality with the superior immanence of the powerful Father in heaven, in your soul. And that's precisely how you practice sexual magic with the Iao. Because in the sexual act, you have to be religious, united with God. That is called religion. That's the true religion. When you become one, because if you are not in the sexual act, you are divided. But in the sexual act, you are one. And remember, God is one, but he's not outside, there in heaven. No, he's inside of you. When you are in a sexual act, God is one. And if you pollute the sexual act, you are insulting that only God within you. Thank you very much.
The presentation of this lecture was made possible by donations from listeners like you. Help Gnostic Radio to help others. Make a donation by visiting GnosticRadio.org. For questions and deeper understanding of this lecture, we invite you to explore the wide variety of resources available on our websites. Thank you for your support. May all beings be happy.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at GnosticTeachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy.